Skyboat Media, in conjunction with 1012 Entertainment, presents General Murders by Loren D. Estleman, read by Robert Forster.
Greek Town. The restaurant was damp and dim and showed every indication of having been hollowed out of a massive stump, with floorboards scoured as white as wood grubs and tall booths separated from the stools at the counter by an aisle just wide enough for skinny waitresses like you never see in Greek Town. It was Greek Town, and the only waitress in sight looked like a garage door in a uniform. She caught me checking out the booths and trundled my way, turning stools with her left hip as she came. "You are Amos Walker?" She had a husky accent and large, dark, pretty eyes set in the wry dough of her face. I said I was, and she told me Mr. Santis was delayed and sat me down in a booth halfway between the door and the narrow hallway leading to the restrooms and back. Somewhere a radio turned low was playing one of those frantic Mediterranean melodies that sound like hornets set loose in the string section. The waitress was freshening my coffee when my host arrived, extending a small right hand and a smiling observation on downtown Detroit traffic. Constantine Xantis was a wiry 5 feet and 90 pounds, with deep laugh lines from his narrow eyes to his broad mouth, and hair as black at 50 as mine was going gray at 33. His light blue tailor-made suit fit him like a sheen of water. He smiled a lot, but so does every other restaurateur, and none of them means it either. When he found out I hadn't eaten, he ordered egg lemon soup, bread, feta cheese, roast lamb, and a bottle of ouzo for us both. I passed on the ouzo. Greek Town used to be more than just fine places to eat. He sighed, poking a fork at his lamb. When my parents came, it was a little Athens, with markets and pretty girls in red and white dresses at festival time, and noise like I can't describe to you. It took in Macomb, Randolph, and Monroe streets, not just one block of Monroe like now. Now those colorful old men you see drinking Ritzina on the stoops get up and go home to the suburbs at dark. I washed down the last of the strong cheese with coffee. I'm a good P.I., Mr. Tentese, but I'm not good enough to track down and bring back the old days. What else can I do to make your life easier? He refilled his glass with ouzo, and I watched his Adam's apple bob twice as the syrupy liquid slid down his throat. Afterward, he was still smiling, but the vertical line that had appeared between his brows when he was talking about what had happened to his neighborhood had deepened. "I have a half-brother, Alexander," he began. "He's 23 years younger than I am. His mother was our father's second wife. She deserted them when Alexander was 6. When father died, my wife and I took over the job of raising Alexander, but by then I was working 60 hours a week at General Motors, and he was 17 and too much for Grace to handle with 2 children of our own. He ran away. We didn't hear from him until last summer, when he walked into the house, unannounced, all smiles and hugs, at least for me. He and Grace never got along. He congratulated me on my success in the restaurant business and said he'd been living in Iowa for the past 9 years, where he'd married and divorced twice. His first wife left him without so much as a note and had a lawyer send him papers 6 weeks later. The second filed suit on grounds of brutality. It seems that during quarrels he took to beating her with the cord from an iron. He was proud of that. He's been here 14 months, and in that time he's held more jobs than I can count. Some he quit, some he was fired from, always for the same reason. He can't work with or for a woman. I kept him on here as a busboy until he threw a stool at one of my waitresses. She'd asked him to get a can of coffee from the storeroom and forgot to say please. I had to let him go. He paused, and I lit a Winston to keep from having to say anything. It was all beginning to sound familiar. I wondered why. When he saw I wasn't going to comment, he drew a folded clipping from an inside breast pocket and spread it out on the table with the reluctant care of a father getting ready to punish his child. It was from that morning's Free Press, and it was headed, "Psychiatrist Profiles 5.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.